here at the George M. Rom Little Theater. Appreciate everybody coming here and had to come across town from our other location, which is normally City Hall and the Council Chambers. Because of the elevator situation, it's put us out to a couple of different locations the last several meetings. Just not too sure what the schedule will be for our next meeting, but I'm sure the city clerk and the council president will make that decision come tomorrow by Wednesday afternoon, early morning, I should say. We should know that. So just to let everyone know how we arrived at this, because we had to find a spot, and the other spot I was told was being utilized, and another location that I was looking into we could not use. So I want to thank the Deputy Superintendent Mike Thomas and Ken Thompson from the school department. He works in the building and grounds, and they worked with me to get this setting. Deja vu for me, and it was 20 years, yeah, Timmy, it was, yeah. But and Council Fowle as well, you won the pool. But anyhow, appreciate you all being here. Just a couple of things before we do begin. Again, City Council President and Chairman of the of this committee could not be here this evening, so he asked me to step up and take his place. So I'm sure he'll be back at our next meeting. I just want to make mention of a couple of things, as the Council President usually does a little bit of housekeeping, but just a couple of mentions to some people that worked for the City of Brockton for many years and passed away just recently over the last week or two. One of which was Mr. Walter Raleigh, and everybody knew Walter, and brother to our DPW Commissioner, Larry Raleigh. He passed away last week, former school police officer, former a park police officer, a great guy to the City of Brockton. And I also want to make mention Mr. Richard Dick Carney, who also worked for the Brockton Public Schools, city employee for good many years, and was part of the the custodial staff, as well as he did negotiate contracts, which Mr. Councilor Cruz and I would know. Both our fathers worked with him for a good many years. But both those gentlemen put in their time due here in the city. So just a quick moment of peace for them. Appreciate that. We'll definitely miss them. May they rest in peace, and sympathy to their families. I also want to make mention that item number 7, which you have on your agenda, is going to be postponed this evening. We could do that now if you wish, because the mayor could not be here. He is ill this evening, but still wants to be a part of the conversation. So he asked that we postpone this till the next finance committee meeting. So I'd entertain a motion. Motion has been made and seconded that we postpone that until the next finance meeting. All in favor of that? Opposed? Postpone to that next meeting. The items that are before us this evening, the first 5 items, are public hearings. And they're public hearings because of the layout of private streets to public streets, and we have to hold a public hearing when we go through these such types of orders. So as you see, items number 1 through 5, what we're going to do is we're going to start with, at this point in time, I will convene and start to have a public hearing, and we're going to start with, first one will be on number 1, so I'll have them read number 1 first, and then I'll open it up for hearing.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the City of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Bernard Road from Rodney Street easterly and northerly, a distance of about 1,566 feet, and for that purpose, it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay out as a public street or way. Invited, Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
Thank you. At this time has arrived. I'm going to declare a public hearing, and at this time, I open the public hearing for anybody that is in favor of this order. I'd ask them to come up to the podium and state their name to the clerk, and then we can go from there. If anyone's here in favor of, Commissioner, go ahead.
Good evening, councilors, and thank you very much for that acknowledgement.
You're welcome.
As far as the DPW, we have no objections to this. There is no land taking, so.
Okay.
We're all in favor.
All in favor of, great.
All in favor of this acceptance.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Is there anyone else that wants to be heard in favor of this particular order? Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed. Anybody here in opposition? Anybody here in opposition? Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed. Counselor, anything you wish to say? I know it's in your...
I am responsible for the first three
okay.
of these public hearings. These roads are, you know, treated just the same as public ways, but they're not eligible to be repaired. Legally, the city doesn't even have to plow them. It's really concerning to see that we have so many of these private ways. The people on these roads pay the same taxes, the same fees, bills, and everything else as any other resident of the city. But when it comes to their roads, something they have to deal with every day, they're not eligible for the same treatment. These items are not a vote on whether or not we're paving these roads. This is just a vote on making them eligible to be paved.
Okay, very good, Counselor. So you want to make a motion on this particular one so we can move it forward?
Yes, I'd like to move favorable recommendation.
Motion's been made and seconded for a favorable recommendation back to the full City Council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full City Council. Favorable recommendation. Item number two, Madam Clerk.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Bernard Circle from Bernard Road northerly and easterly to Bernard Road, a distance of about 605 feet. And for that purpose, it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay out as a public street or way. Invited, Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
Very good. Time having arrived, I'm going to open up the hearing at this time. If there's anybody here in favor of, I wish to have them come up to the podium and state their name to the clerk.
Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner.
Good evening.
Good evening. We have no objections to this also, Councilor. There's no taking of any private property. So.
Okay.
Okay.
Same. Thank you. Very good. Anyone else here in favor that wants to be heard in regards to this particular order? Anyone else? Come up to the podium. If not, I'll declare that part of the hearing closed. Anybody here in opposition? Anyone here in opposition? I'd ask for them to come up and state their name. No opposition? I declare that part of the hearing closed and the hearing closed on this item. Councilors.
Move to recommend favorably.
Motion has been made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full City Council. Favorable recommendation. Item number three, Madam Clerk.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Bourne Street from Winter Street northerly, a distance of about 1,737 feet, and for that purpose it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay out as a public street or way. Invited, Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
Again, time having arrived, I declare the hearing open for anyone to come forth and speak in favor of. Just give your name to the clerk.
Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner. We have no objections to this also. There is no taking of any land.
Great, thank you. Anyone else that wants to be heard in favor of, please come forward, state your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed. Anyone here in opposition? Is anyone here in opposition? I'd ask you to come forward and state your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed and the hearing closed. Councilors?
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for favorable recommendation. All in favor? Opposed? Favorable recommendation back to the full City Council. Item number four.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Talbot Street from Partridge Drive, southerly, a distance of about 502 feet to the southerly lines of lots 172 and 183, and for that purpose, it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay out as a public street or way. Invited, Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
Again, I declare the hearing open. If there's someone here in favor, anyone in favor, come to the podium and state their name.
Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner. We have no objections to this, and there's no taking of any private property.
Very good, thank you. Anyone else that wants to speak in favor of the same order? Anyone else that has any words to say? Please come forward. Anyone in opposition? Does anyone here in opposition to this particular order? Please come forward. Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed and the hearing closed. Motion been made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Item number 5.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Partridge Drive from Old Ash Street westerly to Emory Street, a distance of 733.61 feet. And for that purpose, it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay out as a public street or way. Invited, Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
Again, I declare the hearing at this time open. If there's anyone here in favor, please come forward and give your name to the clerk.
Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner. And also, we have no objections to this, and there is no taking of private property.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone else that wants to speak in favor of this particular order? Anyone else in favor? Seeing none, I'll declare that part of the hearing closed. Anyone here in opposition? Is anyone here in opposition? Seeing none, I declare that part of the hearing closed and the hearing closed. Motion's been made and seconded to recommend favorably. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council with a favorable recommendation. Thank you, and thank those that did come out this evening in regards to this matter. Councilor Borgard.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Could I ask to move item 9 ahead to for these out of order for Senator Michael Brady, please?
Motion's been made and seconded. We're going to take item number 9 out of order. All in favor of that? Opposed? Number 9 out of order. Madam Clerk, would you read number 9?
Resolve to invite Senator Michael Brady to respond to City Council inquiries as to the status of the Ganley Building. Invited, Senator Michael D. Brady.
Good evening, Senator. Come right up to the podium. You're familiar with podiums.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Council. but we'd have to think, well, how, yeah. Senator, nice to see you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the rest of the council for inviting me tonight. It brings back memories to myself in 1996 when
right.
I served with you on the school committee here. Of course, I was a lot thinner than the less gray hairs.
That was just a short-lived stay, though. That was
absolutely.
Right, yeah.
Well, we did have a special election in the middle of winter a year later.
That's right.
I was very grateful to the citizens of Brockton. I was elected to the city council long before I got into the state house there, so thank you.
You're welcome, Senator. I guess the item that's before us, Councilor, you would, Councilor Borgard, you would file the resolve.
I had invited the Senator because we were not receiving a response from the Department of Capital and Asset Management and Maintenance on the situation, the status of the Ganley Building, and the Senator has been kind enough to come here this evening to give us an update.
Thank you, Councilor. And just to let the public know, this is a building on Main Street, which is directly across from the end of Belmont Street. It was the old Ganley Building that those of us that grew up in the city remembers the stores that were downtown and all that. It's right next to Joe Angelo's and the Cristal Cafe and the Tambu Restaurant. And it goes back many years. Back when I served with some of you on the city council, we'd work for years to try to get something downtown with a college collaboration. Due to the beautiful new high school that we're sitting in tonight, built in 1970, that moved out of downtown, and then the mall is getting built, and this happens to every community. It affected our downtown, and we've been trying for years to get some type of college collaboration downtown. So finally, working with Senator Tom Kennedy, who was with us at the time, and the rest of the delegation, and myself, we worked with Governor Patrick. In 2008, he approved a $24.7 million for a new Allied Health Center at the Christo's, former Christo site, and he also approved funding for a downtown college collaboration. And it was all approved under his administration. So it was work with the University of Massachusetts, Bridgewater State, and Massasoit to do something with that Ganley building to bring a college collaboration downtown, all approved under the former administration. And the city had owned the building at the time. They sold it to the state. So everything was moving forward, and then a new administration was elected in the governor's office and so forth. And like any new administration, they look at a lot of expenditures. And they decided to put a hold on a lot of projects in downtown, not only Brockton, but Framingham had a community college down the Cape to look at all expenditures to review everything. And in the process, the building has been sitting idle. So with a lot of inquisitions from not only the council and myself, we did reach out to DCAM, the Department of Capital Asset Management, and they told us that right now they're looking to secure the building, put some money into it to make it safe, and they have not come up with a concise plan of what they're going to do with the building after that. And I've got concerns because it's a vacant building downtown. I know our state delegation has concerns as well. I know a lot of the councils have concerns. But at this point, they're looking to just make the building safe and secure. And I know there's a lot of discussions whether the building should have come down or not. Right now, the state owns the building. It's under the DCAM office. If it does have to come down at some point, it's their responsibility and it's funded through them. It doesn't cost the city anything. I know there's talk about whether the city should take the building back over again. The only issue with that is if it happens, then it'll be the city's responsibility and it'll be the cost be burdened on the city of Brockton, which I've talked to the administration here that I know the city's in a tight budget. So right now the state DCAM office has said they're going to secure the building, make it safe and secure, and then I've also reached out to the governor's office and the lieutenant governor's office. We're in the process of getting a meeting with our state delegation to sit down with the lieutenant governor to come up with a concise plan. In regards to the college ideas, everything's been put on the back burner with that, unfortunately. We've all worked very hard, but due to the governor's budget constraints, he's put all these community colleges on hold, not just Brockton.
Right.
And we're working. I think it's very important we do something with that downtown college collaboration, but unfortunately, it's all been put on hold. So that's the latest update with it.
Okay.
Beyond that, we don't have any new information. I know that I've been in contact with the Department of Capital Asset Management, and I've got a call from the lieutenant governor's office today in my office. She's going to give us some dates to sit down with the delegation to try to come up with a plan for that building.
Okay. Very good, Senator. Councilor Beauregard, any? Do you have any questions? Or?
Well, if we had resolved number 10 here, where we had invited the lieutenant governor to speak again this evening on. So at this point, I know that my colleague, the president of city councils, also has a resolve that he had filed. And he's waiting to hear some more information as to the status of the Ganley building. He's not here with us this evening, so he said that he would, bring back that resolve to get more concise details as they continue to take place. So at this point, I guess, I believe that we know what's happening, and we're in limbo because until you meet with the lieutenant governor and the other delegation, then we'll know more as the time comes. So I believe that at this point,
contact with some of the councilors on this building, both Council Monahan, who represents the other side of Main Street, mm-hmm. and the other councilor, Beauregard. So I'm happy because I know our time is very valuable. We can't always make meetings here, but I'm happy to send any correspondence or whether it be even over the phone to. Any new news we get, I'm happy to share it with the council. I'm very fortunate that the great relationship the city council does have with our state delegation. So I think we're all on the same page with us. We want to see something done with this building. But until the administration decides what they're going to do, it's kind of waiting to see when we have a meeting with them.
Okay. Councilor Cruz.
Thank you. I just want to thank Senator Brady for being here tonight. But I, for one, I know there's been a lot of, I know our president and I know Councilor Beauregard are anxious to get this back. I think it's hugely important that we pay attention to what was mentioned by the senator tonight. And speaking with Kasseri, this building has been all but condemned. and it's going to cost, I believe, minimum of hundreds of thousands, possibly $1 million to take it down. I don't want it back yet.
Right.
I want the piece of property back after they take it down. But I think we need to be a little careful how pushy we are about getting it back, because right now we don't want it back, in my opinion. And I'll just say one item before we move on to number 10. I find it, I don't see the Lieutenant Governor. She was able to make it here Friday night on very short notice for the mayor, but I guess she couldn't make it here tonight for some real business for the city. But I'll hold my tongue on that one.
Thank you, Councilor.
Thank you.
Yeah. Councilor Barnes.
I just want to follow up on something that you mentioned. So you said that you were in communication with DCAM, and at this particular point, the plan is to at least secure the building.
Yes.
So that no further deterioration happens, or, you know, God forbid we get more, you know, rainy weather or windy weather or something that
Plus, obviously, for public safety reasons. When it was privately owned, there was a battle back and forth between a former owner and a owner after that, and there was windows removed by the private owner, so... Mm-hmm. There was water damage in the building and everything else. And as Councilor Cruz mentioned, it is probably at the point that if nothing gets done, it may have to come down because of public safety reasons. And I'm not an engineer, but that being said, it is the governor's administration who is responsible. The state is responsible. So right now, if anything has to be done with the building, it's not the burden of the city of Brockton. It's
right,
the burden
right.
of the state.
I understand, but I didn't know if they told you what that consisted of. What does it mean if that building is going to be secure? Are there going to be scaffoldings around it?
Right. All they told me, they've sent some people into the building to look at it. They're going to have people meeting over the course of the summer, trying to get it safe and secure. They have not gone into specific details other than making it safe and secure. And I've got concerns because I don't want to see another vacant building downtown. But again, it falls on their purview because they're in charge of it, the Office of DCAM.
Well, can I just suggest to you that in your meeting with them, if you can maybe get a report or something, if they've been in there and they've done an evaluation
sure.
of the building, everybody understands the building is in horrible, you know, disrepair and it probably can't be saved. But just so we can kind of get an accurate, up-to-date condition report about, you know, what's going on with that building.
Absolutely.
From our superintendent of buildings.
Right. And right now they have stated that they're looking to put the money into it to keep the building up and standing. So they're saying that so far it can be saved. Now, I don't know if they get in there and do more deeper work with their engineers if they're going to determine otherwise. But right now they're looking to keep the building up and safe and secure. And the biggest concern I have is what are you going to do with it afterwards? I just don't want a building mothballed and sitting vacant downtown. I'm sure none of the city wants to do that either. So we're hoping that they come up with a concise plan to do something with the building. And I know that it would have been a great, you know, we're all in the same page to try to get something downtown because it's so important. I looked at my days at Northeast University in Wentworth, some of the most difficult neighborhoods of Boston. They expanded, they invested. Now you've got a coffee shop, you have a dry cleaners. It helps the small businesses as well because either college kids or their parents have money to invest in the area. And we were hoping for years to get something for that downtown. But right now, under the new administration, they put a lot of community colleges on hold, and all they've stated to us is they're looking to make the building safe and secure, and they have not had a plan beyond that. So I know all three leaders of the colleges were all on board. They had a plan to do something with this. Unfortunately, everything's been on hold with the new administration, and I'm hoping to meet with the Lieutenant Governor as soon as possible. I've talked to her briefly in conversation, but we have not had a sit-down with her office in the administration to come up with a concise plan. And hopefully, she did call my office today to give us a couple dates that hopefully it'll work for all of us to sit down.
Okay, and just for clarification, so I've always understood it to be that this particular parcel that we're looking at is kind of the part above the storefronts on the ground, like that those other little areas are owned, those other little shops are owned by different people. I know that Joe Angelo owns another little kind of an old hair salon in mm-hmm. there. And then you got the Ideal Jewelry Exchange
right
over there. And then
right.
you got all those things on the bottom of that building. So what is there any talk about what's going to happen with those? Or how can
no,
you take a building down and leave the bottom?
No, they're separate buildings.
If you're looking straight ahead when you're coming down Belmont Street, the old Ganley building, that's all owned by the state. So the
well,
Joe
see,
Angelo's...
My friend actually had a lease right underneath there for a massage parlor, and then something happened and she lost her money or something. So I know...
I don't know about that. Could have been under different ownership. Census State has taken over. They own that Ganley building.
Right.
Joe Angelo owns the building next door. If you're looking at the Ganley building to the left...
No, he's also got a little parcel in between there because we were looking at that for
rent. But that's part of his building. It's not anything to do with the Ganley building.
Right.
See, his building is all the brick because he rented out his son-in-law or his stepson has a barbershop on the corner.
It's actually right outside.
He has nothing to do with the Ganley building right now. That's all owned by the state.
Okay.
Council? Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being here, Senator. You did touch a few minutes on part of my question about, about the College Collaborative. But is there any way that we can approach it a little differently, that you, in speaking with the governor, the lieutenant governor, can approach it differently? Originally, when it was to come to Brockton, it was under education. It was really to bring the colleges to the Main Street and Massasoit's science building. But we're in dire need of help downtown.
Absolutely.
And we need it for, can we approach it from the economic development part? Can we tell them that we need to get something down there instead of pushing for, under a different type of a grant or something to get something into that building?
I would say any correspondence that the city council wants to put forth, you can send it to my office or directly to the governor. I'm happy to share any information from the city council with the administration as with the DCAM office. Unfortunately, when the new administration came into office, they cut a lot of funding. I got money, $10 million in a transportation bond bill for two-way traffic on Main Street. Tommy Kennedy, a former senator, was working with us on that. He also got funding for the intersection of Massasoit. We had funding with the transportation bond bill to do that all over. There was funding for a traffic light up on Quincy Street up in Ward 6. There was the Allied Health Center that got approved under the past administration. There was going to be a beautiful new building, the gateway coming to the east side of Brockton. The nursing program alone has a waiting list of over 100 students with perfect grade point averages. As we know, healthcare is where the jobs are, but everything's been put on hold right now, and it's unfortunate. And I know that, like the city, the state has to balance a budget, and there's some budget constraints. Our healthcare costs have gone through the roof, but the sad part is these were all economic benefits to Brockton. The Allied Health Center was part of an economic development bill that's going to end at some point in this coming year, that we're working to rewrite another further economic development bill. But unfortunately, everything's kind of put on hold, and not just Brockton. There was a community college for Framingham down the Cape, and then the one in Taunton they were going to put in downtown Taunton. They put it in the mall in Taunton. That has no benefit to their downtown. So we've got a lot of great ideas on the table, but unfortunately, this would have been the icing on the cake for downtown. I've been working on it since I've been on the city council. I know some of the councils here have been on the same page in some of the former administrations, but unfortunately, everything's been put on hold, and we've been fighting. And the good news is, with the help of our new representative, Jerry Cassidy, we're able to keep the DA's office downtown, which is huge for Brockton. The DA's building has been in dire straits with mold and everything else on Belmont Street. They had to store evidence down at the Middleborough State Police Barracks, so they couldn't even store evidence here, which costs us all money and time. Luckily, with the help of our delegation, we're able to keep the DA's office downtown. They're going to house many state troopers in downtown. They're going to be able to store evidence. That's going to save us a lot of money. And the two courthouses are within a stone's throw from each other. So that's great news, but we still need something else, as we all know. And this college collaboration would have been a great benefit to our downtown. Unfortunately, we're in a difficult situation. We're trying to work with this administration. We've conveyed, all of us at the state level, and I know our mayor's conveyed too, how important this is for our downtown, because it's tough. I kid, we've got three businesses here that are just barely hanging on. We've got a Chinese restaurant that's open at night on Legion Parkway in an old place called the Alamo that's been there from 100 years ago. There's nothing else, and I kid, even the criminals don't hang around anymore because there's nothing downtown. I mean, it's tough. We're fighting day in and day out at the state level. I know everyone here on the council's been fighting, and these businesses are doing good. There's been many functions downtown for these businesses and everything else, but we need more to bring people downtown, and plus with the traffic. We're trying, the conduit was already put under the roadway back under the units administration, so we've got the thing in place to help get two-way traffic and everything else, but unfortunately, everything's been put on hold right now, and we're trying to convey how important this is for our downtown.
And I agree with you, and thank you for that. So you do believe that if we do, it will help to send letters?
I think any correspondence will help. It doesn't mean it's going to be guaranteed, of course, because never know. But I know our state delegation is all on the same page. We're working together. Any help locally from the city? I've talked to the mayor's office as well. He's trying to work for downtown, and I know any correspondence that you have with the mayor as well could help.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
Senator, how are you?
Good, and yourself, Councilor?
I think you mentioned it to Councilor Cruz, or at least he actually suggested it, but you kind of agreed that it's going to take millions of dollars or possibly a million dollars to take that building down.
I don't know what the exact cost, but it's going to cost quite substantially.
Well, that leads me to my next point. We are the only, the largest community in Massachusetts without a four-year college presence.
Mm-hmm.
The only one. The largest out of all the communities without a four-year college presence. And yet, when you look at the State House, you see a State House that's the Democrats actually have a veto-proof legislator. And yet, you've got a governor that comes in and slashes the only hope, serious hope, that our downtown had. And then somehow, the party that actually is there from the previous administration that supported this whole project doesn't do a thing to lift its... I understand that some of these other communities are going through the same thing,
mm-hmm.
but you cannot compare the Cape with Brockton. The issues that we have in Brockton are Brockton issues.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that bothers the daylights out of me is the fact that any time that the Beacon Hill has an opportunity to step up and help this community out, we somehow let the administration off the hook by not fighting hard enough, in the sense that, to be honest with you, those dollars and cents for Brockton should have been fought for by Beacon Hill, the folks that are representing us, that want to see this community move forward. And I'm not talking about yourself in the city delegation.
Right.
I'm talking about the party itself,
mm-hmm.
that's in power up there, that doesn't step up to help this community out. And it seems that we always kind of, we lay back, we cross our arms and say, well, that's the way the state wants to do it. That's the way the governor wants to do it. And frankly, that's not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think it needs to be said in those kinds of a tone, in the sense that we have had enough. You know, this community gets penalized on a regular basis. You know, we're not given discounts in our state taxes because we are Brockton.
Right.
We pay taxes like every other community in this Commonwealth. But for some odd reason, anytime they feel like chopping something from Brockton, they just chop it with no consequences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've been looking since the days of the Harrington administration. I remember being part of that administration, trying to get the downtown two-way traffic moving. You know, there's monies in the bond. There was money that was put in, and it was taken back out again. It was money being put in and taken back out again. And for some odd reason, I frankly have an issue, not necessarily with the administration, but the fact that Beacon Hill, who is supposed to be on our side and heavily Democrat, that's able to override just about any veto from the governor, hasn't really done anything to help this community out. And that's the message that I want to make sure that gets back into Beacon Hill, knowing that, you know what, the taxpayers of this community and some of us in the leadership in this community are not going to sit idle and put up with this.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not necessarily, I honestly don't blame the governor for coming in and pushing his issues. You know, Brockton didn't support him, you know. But the fact is, we support the Democratic Party that overwhelmingly has the ability to override any veto, and they have not done that to protect and help the citizens of this city.
Well, we did override a lot of his vetoes last year with the budget. He did a lot of vetoes on a lot of issues across the board. We overrode his vetoes, but then what he did was, before the end of the year, he did 9 seat cuts, which is separate. And he has a right, because his administration controls us, unfortunately. It's passing an economic development bill, and then DCAM, Department of Capital Asset Management, controls the building downtown. So it's under their purview. Now, we have no authority to override. He can postpone funding for things, unfortunately, which that's what he's basically done. He didn't necessarily even cut the Allied Health Center at Massasoit, but it's put it on the back burner. And if there's no money in the state, he can come up with his budget proposals, he or she, whoever the governor is. And that's what they've done. They said, they're saying that there's not enough money to fund these things, and there's a big battle going on because I'm the newly appointed chair of revenue. We're looking at every means possible to bring more revenue into the state. There's a lot of things on the table. There's fantasy sports that the state of New York gets a ton of money for. We don't get enough revenue into Massachusetts for that. We're looking to get more revenue for that. Even though we were against at the local level the passage of the legislation of the marijuana implication, that's passed by the voters. So we're looking at what kind of revenue we're going to get off that with taxes. We're all looking at B&Bs. We're looking at other means because we are, unfortunately, the private sector is booming right now. The Commonwealth, because of health care costs and everything else, is not producing as much revenue. Capital gains 2 years ago, people paid in advance on their capital gains. We got a ton of money in. So the way the law states, and maybe we can work to change the law, but right now it falls under the governor's purview to make decisions. We've overridden his vetoes in the past, but then when he does these 9C cuts, or he doesn't necessarily cut something, but he puts it down the road, it's like kicking the can down the road, and that's what he's done. And that's why I'm trying to get a meeting, and I plan on getting a meeting with the lieutenant governor as soon as possible. We've been working on this for a while. I'll see her out at an event like the other night, catch her ear, and she did finally call my office today and said they are going to be working on a couple days that our delegation can sit down with her to come up with this plan. But I am very frustrated as well as yourself because I totally agree with you. It is a Democratic-led legislation and so forth, but unfortunately, the way it is written is the power is in the governor's hands on these bills. Now, that being said, this economic development bill that passed several years ago, that's going to end coming up in the near future. We're looking to file another piece of legislation to put another economic development bill out there to try to get this moving, because not only for the college, but for everything, there's a lot of things needed, and especially for the city of Brockton. And I know we take the brunt of a lot of services that we provide for the residents, but we don't get the bang for the buck, and I totally agree with you on that.
Yeah, because if you look at it, we're the only city in this entire county. We are the largest city south of Boston. So anything that becomes an issue in this region becomes a Brockton problem.
Right.
But you know what? The state isn't looking at us as the problem solver mm-hmm. for the state in this particular region. You look at funding that comes down for immigrant classes, citizenship reparation classes, any of those particular things, we don't get a dime from the state to help us with that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you look at some of the other issues that exist in the community. Mr. Chairman, just give me a little leeway here in terms
little.
Of a couple weeks ago, the chief of police came in front of us, you know, to ask her to accept a grant from the state where the city of Brockton was given $150,000. The city of Lawrence got $850,000 for mm-hmm. the same grant. You know, so the issue is that why is it that Brockton is always on the short end of the stick when it comes down to getting funding Council. From the Commonwealth of Massachusetts? It happens on a regular basis. There was another grant a couple weeks before that the city got $100,000+. Newton got it about $600,000. Newton, you know. But it
Councilor.
Seems it seems that we're always on the back end of the state looking at us to say, you're part of this Commonwealth, you are taxpayers in this community, you know, we can't just sit here and have a vacant building in the middle of our city and everybody just keeps, you know, going around saying, well, you know, one of these days they're going to fix this building, one of these days they're going to mothball it, one of these days it might come down, one of these days it might go
Councilor,
up.
Councilor.
I mean, that's just not enough.
No, I'm not trying to cut you out, but I think the Senate is getting your word. I'm sure he's understanding what your situation is, and we all feel that same way, to be truthful with you. We do, and I'll be the same. But is there anyone else who wants to be heard before I go back to Councilor Beauregard? I know you had another question, but I want to make sure everyone's had their chance to be heard. Councilor Beauregard.
First of all, again, I want to thank the Senator for coming this evening. We appreciate his efforts. And I know that he's not going to let us down. One of the biggest reasons that I asked him to come is so we could get the details. We want to continue to have conversations, transparency, and how would I say, the facts and not the fiction of where we're going in this area. And it is true that there are several buildings either by the state or the county that are in this city. And a statement was made actually by one of the individuals that works toward economic development that they're like the worst landlords because they don't maintain their buildings, don't pick up the trash, and keep a different, you know, the, how would I say, a better appearance. So that is one of our concerns. So I'd be happy to provide correspondence and information to the Lieutenant Governor, as we do not see her here this evening, and we do not have the Department of Capital and Asset Management and Maintenance attend prior. So we're looking forward to providing the information and having a continued conversation on this. So again, I want to thank you.
And I thank you. And any time, I know everyone's schedule is busy. My schedule is busy. Everyone here on the council's schedule is busy. If you can't make it to the State House, any time you're always welcome to send. I mean, my office is always available to come in to visit me or to send correspondence via email or letters or whatever. But on any issue, and it does help their strength in numbers, so any correspondence the city wants to send collaboratively, I think will help. We've got a lot of hearings coming up and bills, just like you have a lot of bills and legislation right here. We've got thousands and thousands of bills we deal with at the state level. I just had my first hearing on the Revenue Committee. Some bills go through a long process, and I think it's helpful. And then I know that the, as was mentioned, the Lieutenant Governor was here the other night for the mayor's speech. It's unfortunate she couldn't be here tonight, but we are working on every means possible to help Brockton out. And we did get another grant for some bridge repair work, which was fortunate the other day. And Brockton got more money than a lot of towns around us.
Good.
We did get some money for Easton as well, which is part of my district, because my area goes from Northeastern all the way to Hanover and Plimpton, but Brockton is the main part of the whole district, and we were able to get some grant money for that. And also, another thing that's important is the with the police coverage for the Shannon grant, that Brockton, and I used to serve in the Committee of Public Safety, that we're able to get an increase on the money for the Shannon grant, which is very helpful to the city of Brockton. So
I know you're looking out for a senator, so I know you'll continue to do a good job in doing that.
And
so you know where we're coming from.
And you all know me. I'm always around anytime you want to meet with me. I'm more than happy.
And anytime anything gets written down into a report, then just make sure it gets forwarded to us so that we can
sure.
see it as well. Any other questions for the senator? I know he's got a schedule. Seeing none, councilors, what's your wish on this one?
Motion to approve, sent to the
second.
Motion's been made and seconded, sent back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Councilors, thank you, Senator. While we're here on this page, number 10, I mean, what's going to be the wish of the councilors there? There's no sense in having discussion about that because the Lieutenant Governor is not here. Obviously, no one's heard. Motion's been made and seconded to postpone on that item. All in favor? Opposed? That item is postponed. We'll go back to beginning, and we go back to item number 6, Madam Clerk.
Order appropriation of the total grant in the amount of $70,000 from Massachusetts Department of Public Health Bureau of Substance Abuse Services, BSAS, grant to City of Brockton Mayor's Office, Massachusetts Department of Public Health Bureau of Substance Abuse Services, grant fund. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer.
And as I mentioned earlier, the mayor is not well this evening, so Mr. Condon's here to speak on this as well.
Good evening, councilors.
Thank you.
This is a grant from the Department of Health, Public Health for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and it is a regional grant through the city of Brockton, but it also includes the communities of East Bridgewater, Whitman, and Rockland. It has a focus of opioid abuse prevention, and it has two main focuses, actually. One is on the consumption or controlling the use of the opioids, and the second is on the consequences of overuse. Several strategies in the grant, educating youth about the dangers of opioid abuse through the schools, educating parents on monitoring the behavior of their children, increasing knowledge and access to prescription monitoring, and drug take-backs for purposes of controlling the use. On the consequences side, it promotes the use of the Good Samaritan 911 mechanism, where you can phone in an overdose situation and not be in jeopardy of your own safety on it, immunity for that. And training for overdose, taking care of overdose situations for bystanders, other users, family, friends, first responders, and increasing access to Narcan. It's only $70,000, but it has a broad strategy. It's administered through the city for those communities, also through the control of the Department of Public Health, and the $70,000 has already been allocated if it's approved by the council.
Councilor Cruz.
Thank you. Just is there any city matching?
No matching.
That's all for me. Thank you.
Councilor Azak.
Which department will be doing?
It's through the mayor's office, Councilor.
Through the mayor's office and not the police department?
No, Karen Capiello. It's administered through her.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded to approve. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Favorable recommendation. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Next item, which will be item number 8. Number 7 has already been postponed.
Resolve, the city solicitor or his designee and the collector treasurer appear before a committee of the city council to discuss the policies, procedures, and financial data relating to taking possession of properties. And be it further resolved that data relating to properties taken by tax title during the fiscal year 2016 and in fiscal year 2017 through the date of this resolve, including address, assessed property value prior to tax title proceedings, amount of proceeds from sale of individual properties, name of person or entity to whom property was sold and transferred, and expenses relating to taking possession of the properties be made available to the City Council 5 days prior to any public discussion to allow for proper review. Invited, Philip C. Nasrallah, City Solicitor or his designee, Martin S. Brophy, Treasurer.
And both those gentlemen are present. I know Councilor Fowle, you file this one. Anything you want to say before, or you just want to wait and ask some questions?
Both gentlemen for being here. I file this resolve because I wanted to try to wrap myself around this issue. It's not something that we did when I was in office. We did not take properties for tax title, to the best of my memory. Number one, we didn't have the resources to take care of them. We were already constrained with police and fire services. But now it seems like we're doing quite a bit of it. And so I wanted to talk with both gentlemen about this, and I'd like to thank whoever put together all of the enclosures that were sent out. I don't know if that's Mr. Brophy's office, but I really appreciate it getting it in advance. I did send a couple of questions in advance to Solicitor Nasrallah, and I'd like to thank him for providing this March 2008 letter, which was issued by the Mass Department of Revenue. Once a house is taken for tax title, we as a council have absolutely no say in what happens to that house, who buys it, whether it meshes into our overall economic development plan. It is strictly the mayor and the real estate custodian. And notwithstanding an ordinance that says something different, where there can be a list and it has to be approved and the list can be modified, that ordinance really, and I'd ask the solicitor, basically should be repealed, because it has absolutely no standing. Is that a fair statement?
That is correct.
So I guess to Mr. Brophy, I would ask, what are the policies for taking someone's house for tax title? Is there a minimum value on the property? Is it geographical? How does this evolve? Who makes that decision and we take
as
that
treasurer,
step?
As treasurer, that's my decision as okay. to whether we proceed to foreclose. Basically, this is through a property we proceed to foreclose on is years of inactivity, the tax title account increasing, no bills being paid in the tax office, whether they be current water bills, whether they be the real estate bills. My first step, when it gets to the point where it's usually a principal amount that I'll $15,000-$20,000 principal, then you're talking interest on top of that. So usually when you're talking about the property that we may start proceeding foreclosures on, it's around $30,000-$40,000 in unpaid between taxes and interest. The first thing I do is ask my outside legal counsel to send a letter from his office that to contact the treasurer's office to set up some way of paying this off. That usually draws in most of the people. You'd be surprised, in the history of Munis, we've had over, I just recently did a tax taking. Prior to that, it was 87% of any property that goes into tax title is redeemed. By adding in about 80 properties, it's down to 85.5%. So usually a letter from an attorney saying you've got outstanding taxes, you need to talk to the treasurer, will bring people in. Once someone comes in, we'll work with them. My first goal is to have them pay off what is due in the tax office to kind of stop the bleeding of the tax title account increasing. Once they've done that, we try and set up some kind of minimum deposit towards the tax title account and then a monthly payment plan. And to remain current as the bills come out and pay monthly towards the account.
So periodically you'll get a list of properties for which we have not received tax payments for a protracted period of time, and then you'll decide to send that into tax title.
What I will do is, in tax title, the way tax title, to put it into tax title, each year, four real estate bills go out, a demand after the May due date, which is the legal due date of that bill. Even though we bill quarterly, the legal due date is May 1st. After that, I have to send out a demand notice. 14 days due. If there is an outstanding balance after that 14 days, we have the right to proceed into starting a tax taking. That entails sending a notice of advertisement to the property owner that, you know, you've got outstanding taxes for one particular year, whatever it is. The most recent one I did was 2014. If they come in and pay it, they're fine. If not, it will be advertised in the paper. 14 days after the advertisement of the paper, we have done a tax taking. At that point, what we do is record the unpaid tax amount at the Registry of Deeds. We've basically perfected that lien. It perfects the right of the city to collect this money. It doesn't stay with the owner. It stays with the property. Any years afterwards, we do that once. Any years after, any subsequent years, so for the 2014 taking, once we've done that and recorded those instruments, I can do a 2015 subsequent. So any of those properties that are in tax title going back however many years, if they have unpaid taxes for that subsequent year, it's added to the account.
Okay. Now, on the enclosures which you sent to us, if you could just take me through this for a minute. The column that says amount due a taking, is that...
What those spreadsheets are were the results of the auctions that have been held. If you notice, it would say auction properties, and there's a date and month of when the auction was. So the amount of the taking is basically the principal amount of due that was in tax title when we foreclosed on the property.
So that would be taxes and interest?
Just taxes.
Just taxes.
Not the 16% interest. We can't include that as a recoverable amount because interest, it's just penalties and interest.
All right, and assessed value obviously is assessed value.
Right, and right? That was at the time of the auction.
And this is exactly why I really wanted to look at this, and I think all of us should be aware of what goes on, because Brockton is a city that always has financial pressures. So to the extent that we recoup monies through the auction, it's very beneficial because I presume they go into the general fund to be appropriated. And I'm just looking
actually, proceeds from this auction goes into free cash.
Goes into free cash.
Well, it can't be appropriated immediately. It goes right in. It's free cash. It's not. You don't pay a bill. Basically, it's sold free and clear of all liens, so you can't pay the bill. It just becomes. And I believe it says that in the DOR opinion letter.
Okay. Now, just taking the February 2017 one, and you may or may not be able to answer this, but I noticed assessed value on a piece of property on Sprague Street. Well, amount due a taking was $26,000 and change. Assessed value $191,000. The sale price was $130,000. So, just looking at this, it looks like there was about $225,000 outstanding, and we only got half of that amount. Now,
The assessed value is the assessor's value of the property.
Yes,
it's not an amount due to the city. That's what they would base their tax bill on.
No, I understand that. It just intrigues me that if it's assessed at $191,000, and I presume our assessor's office is pretty good, and there's $26,000 outstanding, to have it sell at $130,000 just seems to me like we didn't really make out very well on that.
Well, in many ways, we owned it at $26,000. That's what we foreclosed on it on. That's the amount that we foreclosed on.
Well, basically. I guess put another
Again,
way.
Principal amount of what we foreclosed on. So what was due to the city in principal was $26,000. We actually, it was sold for $130,000.
Yes, but if the value of that particular piece of property is $191,000, it just strikes me as odd that we wouldn't hold out for a price higher.
Yeah, I mean, that's not something I can answer because I'm not actually part of the auctions, so.
So the list leaves you, goes to the real estate custodian.
At one point I was the real estate custodian, and you know, you have to, having been through auctions, I mean, you basically, these auctioneers will work it until they get to the highest bid. And again, you have to base it on what the city owned it on. Yes, the assessed value is an assessed value based on, for the tax purposes, and that's what it will be taxed at once it goes back on the rolls.
Now, if this if some of these properties, which perhaps are in an economic area that we'd like to, economic development area we'd like to further, could you have a tax titled property and have it declared surplus and sell it with a deed restriction?
There are two options, basically. The real option is it's sold at public auction to the highest bidder. There are properties, and many of them, there's some downtown that we've gone through an RFP process. So, I mean, if there is a property that has some beneficial use purpose for the city, you know, that's in an area you want to develop, yeah, there's a they could be sold through an RFP.
Well, the reason I ask that is that at a public auction, there's no guarantee that a nonprofit might come in, be the successful bidder, mm-hmm. do whatever they're going to do with the property, and then, of course, we'd have no real estate taxes coming in. So that was one of my concerns. I guess you and I had a brief conversation, and I understand that rarely, but it has been done, we've taken properties for tax title where there were tenants mm-hmm. and or somewhat valuable property left there. And I guess, as I asked the solicitor in my email, doesn't that create, Solicitor Nasrallah, some, shall we say, liability for us if we were to take a piece of property and we had tenants? And if the tenants are there, who would collect the rents and who would make sure that the water and sewer fees were paid?
Well, there's always potential liability. However, the safeguards that are in place are the process and procedures that we utilize in taking the property and foreclosing according to the court rules and regulations. The underlying essence of taking of property is to get the property back on the tax rolls and to liquidate it so we can bring the money back into the city, the municipality, that has been stagnant for a period of time that no taxes were paid. So there is somewhat of a process so we can go and get that property back. Now we have had a couple of incidents where there were tenants that were either squatters, tenants at will, that had remained on the property. We commenced eviction proceedings, gave notice, and if we needed to get a bonded mover, we did that to move out their effects, and it was all itemized, so we would minimize or make non-existent the opportunity for any lawsuit against the city. But other than that, if we wait for the tenant to leave, that could be never.
That's true. And last question for either one of you. I take it that when the property is recorded, there has to be a municipal lien certificate, so even though this doesn't account for unpaid water and sewer, do we eventually get that back, if either of you know that?
Well, again, when we do a tax taking, it would include any water and sewer that has been committed onto the real estate bill. So as we, you know, every year with the water sewer bills, the prior year, on the third quarter bill, the prior year's water bills will be linked onto the real estate bill.
All right. Well, on the amount due a taking, though, I thought you said that was just the real estate taxes.
Well, those become real estate bills. I mean, they become part of the real estate bill. So
okay. So it's the real estate and outstanding water and sewer.
Oh, yeah.
And eventually the water and sewer money would get into the enterprise account?
It's an accounting aspect. Again, the property, the bills are unpaid. They don't get paid. You don't sit there and pay the bills outstanding. They're actually, it's based on the way the DOR does it, it's a gap accounting mechanism that would do it.
Well, I thank both of you. I don't know if my colleagues have any questions. I'll certainly ask to look at this periodically because, again, where money is so tight, it's always...
Well, again, Council, these are actually auction properties.
Yes.
I mean, there is a list of tax title properties, of what is in tax title.
Well, I'm just interested in finding out who's buying what and what are we getting back. I guess that's the bottom line for me, so... Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Azak?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure who could answer this question for me, but it is there anything that we do or that we can do to protect the city from somebody coming in and purchasing, for example, this parcel, the one on West Elm Street? It's a rundown. I believe it's the rundown old building that's right next to the... behind the courthouse?
Well, I think that's going to be discussed at the next meeting.
Okay.
I mean, that's...
Definitely. Well, we'll use that just as an example. Say somebody comes into these auctions and purchases one of these buildings or rundown homes. Is there anything that we can do to protect ourselves from them just purchasing them at a good price and just leaving them as is? Can we require them within a certain time to fix them up or...
Well, again, you know, it's very rare that these properties, sometimes it's just land, sometimes it is a building. It's very rare that anyone is living in this building. What you're getting is contractors who will come in, and again, having been part of this, you know, it came back to the treasurer's office in 2007. Myself and Jim Martelli ran some auctions. When I became treasurer, I ran some auctions, and when I was real estate custodian, now it's Ben. You basically have contractors out there or people who may see a property that's a building. They kind of have to do their own research on it. They're looking to rehab, flip it if they're a contractor. So, I mean, they're not looking to own this property to live there, half of them. You know, we've had an occasion, I think I had one person who, it was a person who was buying it for himself, you know, he was the successful bidder. And again, it's a public auction sold to the highest bidder.
Correct. So there's nothing that we can do?
I think you can put some restrictions, possibly, if it's a piece of land, to say that it's a single-family home that's built. I'm not sure, you know, whether you can get into the restrictions of owner-occupied. I'm not sure. You know, that'd be kind of hard to, and I might
still have to abide
one.
By the existing zoning regulations in that particular area.
Okay.
So
the only reason I asked that is
a safeguard that's in place anyways.
Okay. That building is, I just, once again, we'll use that as an example. It's not even my ward, and I, every time I talk to somebody, they're asking, when is something going to be done with it? It's such an eyesore. So that's the reason I'm asking the question. Is there anything we can do to make sure, kind of get things moving a little quickly so we don't have people hold on to them? So legally, you're saying?
My only experience is that when a developer purchases those properties, it behooves them to move as rapidly as possible. Otherwise, they're working on a debt situation. So their function is usually to get it back together and be able to flip it for profit. Otherwise, they wouldn't have purchased it. Very rarely have I seen where somebody purchases the property or land and lets it sit there.
Thank you.
Having seen some of these properties too, and I personally don't set foot in them. I look, kind of peek in if the door is open, or you just kind of look at the property on the outside. You see some of them afterwards, and I mean, they're just turned into beautiful homes. You know, I see them as an eyesore, and then you come back and you look at some of them, and they're turned into livable homes that just...
And that's what we want to see. Right. That's what we want.
Right.
So very good. Thank you.
Councilor Cruz.
Thank you. I just more comment on thank both of you. It seems like this is something we go through about every 5 or 6 years. We get calls from the public that see some of these numbers, and I would only say that assessed value and value have nothing to do with each other in cases like these. I've been to some of these auctions. They're generally the same 5 or 6 contractors who know exactly what they're looking for. They know exactly what number they can put money into these places and then make a profit and sell them quickly. Almost in all cases, by the time we've taken these to tax title, They've been abandoned for a year, 2 years, 3 years. We all know what happens to a house that's empty for a year or 2 years or 3 years. And so almost always you get to the, they get to these houses, there's no copper left inside. There's oftentimes no windows. They come in, and I'm surprised in many cases an assessed value of 192 and for us to get 130,000 is actually on the plus side of where we usually are in those kind of situations. The other part on some of the commercial properties, I have found that since we started this program, we have identified different buildings and worked with the mayor to say, please take that out of the auction because we think we can do better with this under an RFP, and it has worked. You know, the West Elm Street we'll have to talk about next week at the next finance rather when the mayor can come. But we have been able to look at some pieces of property and say we don't want this to go in the auction right now for a particular reason. But the single family pieces are almost always pretty run down and eyesores in particular neighborhoods, and it's been a great program. And I think sometimes we've had some councilors frustrated because the way the state law is written, we don't have a say on it.
Right.
There's a reason the state law is written that way, because every councilor would be, we all have neighborhoods where they'd say, I don't want that piece of property sold because the kids, it's a yard to them. Well, they don't own the piece of property. It's an abandoned piece of property that we used to get tax money on. We don't get that tax money anymore. So my belief is that's why the Department of Revenue and the state law took the city council out, city councils out of that and the local jurisdiction out of that years ago, so that you can't play politics with certain pieces of property. And again, I think it's worked fairly well. And again, I think it's brought in some good money to the coffers. And again, I think the other part that people don't realize is these people who bid on these, they take a chance. And in fact, there was an abandoned house in my ward. I started getting a call from somebody who bought it sight unseen. And then when he got there, realized it wasn't worth even the $15,000 or $10,000 non-refundable deposit that he had put on it. And he kept asking me, how do I get out of this? And I said, you don't. You signed a piece of paper that it's a non-refundable deposit. When you go to these auctions, what you bid, you own it. And certainly you can walk away, but you don't get your deposit back, which is generally $5,000 or $10,000.
Five for residential. I mean, if you're talking a commercial or a good size, you can do 10, 15.
And again, so some of these people, they're developers, and they're taking a gamble, and it doesn't always work for them, but it does get it back on the city rolls. The other concern I do share with Council Falwell, anytime it could be a nonprofit coming in, and particularly with larger homes and things, they could be buying them, and then we have, in a neighborhood, we have what can be a problem. We generally, they don't become problems, but they don't pay taxes, and it is a problem, or a potential problem. Thank you for explaining the program.
I'd actually like to make one point as far as the process for how the city forecloses. A bank can foreclose on a property so much easier than the city. It's really a long process for us. We go in, my attorney, outside legal counsel, they will file a case in land court. The land court will then assign a title examiner to find out who every interested party in this property is. Every interested party is notified of the city's intention to foreclose. If any of them step up, they have the right to pay this property off. If the court is satisfied that everyone was notified, they give a certain date for a response. If no one has responded to that notification, the city then can ask for a judgment in its favor. So it's not like we can just go in and say they owe us 20,000 in taxes and 15 more in interest and own the property in a month. This is a long drawn out process for the city. And that's in some ways how the cost to the city, depending on all the notifications and if someone comes forward, you know, that the cost can actually, legal costs can actually be increased.
Thank you. Council Borg, you're all set?
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Barnes, and I'll go to you, Councilor Fowler.
Just for my own education, so that one-year process, is that kind of like that right of redemption stuff?
No, I'm just saying the process can vary. I mean, again, if a title examiner finds very few interested parties, the notifications, I mean, it can vary. I mean, the process from taking it to tax title to to owning it
mm-hmm.
is years.
But that's what I was asking, like that right of redemption, was that what you were kind of...
That's after the city forecloses.
There's after the city forecloses, okay.
There's a year's right that the previous owner can appeal the foreclosure decree.
Okay, okay.
And what it would be is that they would have to file a case in land court appealing the city's judgment. Mm-hmm. If they walk in to land court, they have to have a means to pay it off. So they have to go fight their case and say, I have my money to pay it, you know, and the judgment would be vacated and they'd be allowed to pay them.
Got it. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Anyone else before Councilor Fowle?
Yeah, just in response to Councilor Cruz, I share your viewpoint that a lot of times there are many, many rundown pieces of property. But if the assessed value is based on the value of the property the prior January 1st, if something has an assessed value this month, it should be based on what it was worth January 1st, 2016, and you would think that the assessor's office would catch up with the fact that it's in deplorable condition and it's not worth that money. The other thing I would say to you is that however noble it is not to have the city council involved, the flip side of that is that you have invested all of the power and authority over every piece of property that's taken for tax title into the mayor and to a real estate custodian who may not even live in the city. So forgive me for being a little careful about this, but I always like to see, you know, trust but verify, make sure we're doing everything we should in terms of disposing of these properties and getting the most back. So, but I do share your viewpoint. There are many where we're very glad to get rid of. So.
Anyone have any other questions? Gentlemen, you're all set?
I'd like to move favorable, and again, my thanks.
Motion's been made and seconded to move favorable back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed goes back to the full city council. I think that we've completed our agenda. Is that correct, ladies?
Yes.
Anything, Councilor Azak?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A moment of personal privilege.
Yes, you may.
I'd like to thank everybody who attended the first Walker Playground planning meeting last Thursday. It was well attended, and it was a lot of hands-on. A lot of groups got together and created their own little playground, what they'd like to see at the Walker's Playground. So I would like to let everybody know that we do have a second meeting planned for April 12th at the Raymond School at 6:30 p.m., and hope to see everybody there again. And if anybody that wasn't there would like to be there, please join us. This is a totally hands-on meeting. You'll get to see plans, talk to our planning department. And if you have any questions, we have posted these meetings on the city website, social media. They've been in the paper. So, and you can always feel free to call me if you have any questions about the meeting. On another note, I'd like to see everybody come out and support our musicians in the city here at Brockton High School on Wednesday evening, April 5th at 7 p.m. The All City Band and Brockton High School Concert Band will be playing here at the high school, and I believe you can purchase the tickets at the door. And on Thursday evening, April 6th at 7 p.m., you have the Brockton High School award-winning Brockton High School Concert Band playing here. It's always a pleasure, and I know some of my colleagues here always attend, and they're really a pleasure to watch and well worth a few dollars that you pay at the door. So hopefully everybody will come out and support the Brockton High School Band. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Anything? Councilor Fowle?
Yeah, just a quick moment of personal privilege.
Yes, you may.
The first meeting of the councilors at large will be on April 13th. At 6:30 at the North Middle School. The agenda is open forum. All four of us will be there and field any questions, hear from residents. So again, April 13th at 6:30 at the North Middle School for those who like to pre-plan.
Is that a Wednesday or a Thursday?
That's a Thursday.
Thursday evening. Okay, April 13th for the Council at Large meeting. That's Thursday. Okay, anything else? Councilors, as I indicated when we started the meeting, I will be in contact with the city clerk in the morning, and between the city clerk and the council president, we'll decide just what our schedule will be to returning back to City Hall or whether we would be coming here. We have all meetings booked here for right now, but if there's a different change, and I believe there may be a little bit of a change, and when the elevator will be worked on, you know, for full repair or full revamping, I believe. So they'll make that decision and let us know, and they'll have to do it in ample time so that everything can get out in the mail. So that being said, any other business to come before this group this evening? Seeing none, meeting adjourned.